This episode, I'll be continuing my interview with a prominent Egyptologist who's also the general director of the Grand Egyptian Museum Project, as well as a member of the editorial board of the Journal of Egyptian Archaeology, as well as a member of the German Archaeological Institute. In my past episode, I interviewed Dr. Tariq Sayed Tawfiq, and actually Dr. Tariq talked to us about why he chose to study archaeology. He talked to us about his master's degree, his PhD degree, his interest in some of the vignettes of the Book of the Dead, as well as his research work in the Memphite necropolis, whether at Saqqara or Abu Sir. He talked to us about many interesting archaeological and Egyptology topics, and today we will be continuing talking to him about his story of success. Welcome with us. Well, the last thing we discussed in the past episode was your post as the general director of the Grand Egyptian Museum. And you spoke about how you were reluctant, but then eventually you became happy about it. Now, are there certain challenges or fears that you're having concerning that post?
No. Actually, of course, I'm doing my best, seeing this post as a national duty, and I see it as a big chance, and this museum has a big potential to be an important landmark for Egypt and to revive its tourism. At the same time, we benefit from Egyptian and international expertise in the field of Egyptology and museology to create the museum of the 21st century.
Now, when we speak about museology, actually, you have published several pieces or articles about some of the research work about that. One of it was about the challenges of database networking concerning museums. How could it be dangerous? Like right now, everything is on the internet. So in what ways might it be dangerous? And would you tell us more about that piece?
Actually, the danger when there is not adequate networking between museums in one country is that the information of moving objects can be lost. On the other hand, if systems break down, the migration of information might be a danger, or during the migration, some important information might get lost. At times of modern warfare, there are different weapons which might interfere with magnetic fields, which could result in a total loss of certain information on digital means. So I think first, you need to have very good networks between the national museums so that there is an easy move of information between these museums, a safe move of information, and an easy way of migration of data. And the other thing is, which I always tend to, is that there must be also still until today a paper backup for the main information always.
I'd like to ask you about being an Egyptologist. Well, does it always require that the researcher has to be part of the digs, or they can be totally two different things?
It is, of course, a big plus if the archaeologist can be a member of certain excavations that he is writing about. But if you're writing about excavations that have been well documented, you can also write about excavations that you have not personally participated in.
What about you? Have you participated in many excavations?
Actually, I was fortunate to participate in two main excavations. Excavations on the island of Elephantine in Aswan. There I was fortunate still to spend some time with the famous German Egyptologist Werner Kaiser, and he asked me at the time to translate the guidebook to the island into Arabic, and this was a very enjoyable and challenging work. Then I also participated in the excavations in Saqqara of the tombs of the high officials of the new kingdom, which is a passion of mine since my master degree, and something that I continue to have great interest for.
Now I'd like to ask you about the excavation at Saqqara, because that, I think, the tomb itself dated to the 19th dynasty, to the reign of Ramses II, and at that time the capital was a bit further to the north and not part of the Memphite necropolis. Now, if the nobleman is living away from the capital, would his tomb still be as fancy or as beautiful as a nobleman living in the capital?
There are several different opinions about this. In my personal opinion, the tombs of the high officials were on purpose located in Saqqara at that time, because the main capital in the time of Ramses II was in Pir-Ramsis, which is in the delta, and the delta, the ground there is fertile, and there, if you bury a person there, the body will not be kept well. So in my opinion, in spite of having the court at Pir-Ramsis, but the tombs were at Saqqara.
Actually, you're also interested in helping the youth, and you try to train them And you're actually doing a lot of, as a guest lecturer in many universities, as well as also some of the international ones, like in Germany, concerning heritage and sciences. So would you tell me about your experience with you, especially in Germany?
Actually, teaching in Germany has shown me that our students in Egypt are actually quite exquisite, and that they are not less than students abroad. But the discipline of the students in Germany was very high, through their school system, they are more ready for discussion. So they ask a lot, and they engage in discussions which are very enriching for teaching. But when I returned to Egypt after my PhD, I also engaged in some project in order to take Egyptian students abroad to raise their skills, especially in something that we were lacking, which is digital epigraphy, how to do the right drawings of archaeological objects in order to make them ready for publication. So I was fortunate to take several assistants of the Faculty of Archaeology to Germany to train them in this field, and now we have some fine epigraphists at the Faculty of Archaeology.
Also, you teach abroad methods of facsimile. I think that when I used to study, that actually in the older times it was done by hand, and you just copy of the piece itself, or you put a transparent paper and you draw the outline. So now how does it work?
Actually, we here benefit from modern technology. When using now the modern means for preparing a facsimile of an object, we do no longer take any paper and put it on the object, by this making any harm to the object, but we take high-resolution photographs, and then these high-resolution photographs are put into an electronic drawing board, and our colleagues have to draw the drawing of the facsimile on the drawing board. This has the plus point that you can easily make corrections, and once you finish, the facsimile is ready for publication.
Now, Doctor, would you talk to us about your awards?
As a student, I was fortunate to get several awards in several different subjects of study, like ancient Egyptian monuments, like hieratic studies. I was also chosen to go to attend a very specialized course in Malta and in Italy, and this was done by the European Union. So this also enhanced my skills and was a sign of excellence. We'll be right back.
a guest lecturer and a professor, especially at some of the universities like Hotels and Tourism or the Faculty of Arts, and these they give a tour guiding major on. And I wonder the standard of the students, especially now that even some of the private universities, they just hand out these certificates, and anybody, or I feel almost that anybody can become a tour guide. The standards you've seen, are they up to the standards of guiding? How do you coach them?
Actually, like anywhere in the world, you have different categories of students. And from my personal experience, you always have some outstanding students who will force you to give them your know-how and will encourage you to give them your know-how. So when you have you're teaching at any class, anywhere, you will always have these outstanding students who you will gladly pass on your knowledge and encourage so that they can be an asset for the future. And actually, they are the ones who also encourage you to cope with the students who are not so brilliant and who are not so willing. But my personal way is that when I go into a lecture, I always put some main information, maybe 10 points, and the student must come out of this lecture with these 10 points.
Dr. Tariq, you were a member of the National Committee that actually made the inventory on the Egyptian Museum of Antiquities at Tahrir Square following the aftermath of the 2011 revolution. Now, was it greatly damaged? To what extent the damage? We've seen pictures that it was bad, especially the upper floor, but to what extent was it damaged?
Of course, every object that is damaged or lost is an unreplaceable loss for Egypt. But yet, I think that Egypt was very lucky, and that concerning the magnitude of this revolution, this was a small sacrifice that happened. At the end, only about 20 objects were lost from the Egyptian Museum at Tahrir, out of a total number of over 120,000 objects. Throughout my inventory work at the museum, I must say that the objects that are there are very well protected by the curators of the museum, and that during my inventory work, which included several thousand objects, I did not find one unreal or even a stolen object.
Doctor, because the time of the episode is almost out, I have to ask you about being a member of the German Archaeological Institute. Now, when did you become a member, and how does it feel being a member of such an esteemed archaeological institute?
I have been a member or selected a member of the German Archaeological Institute in 2015. And this is quite an honorable position in the field of archaeology, which makes you or distinguishes you as a very active member of the archaeological community. It opens for you and your students doors of collaboration with the German archaeological field, at the same time it is a sign that the German Archaeological Institute sees you as a very capable Egyptologist that is also an asset for the German Archaeological Institute.
Another important post, of course all your posts are important, but this one is recent as well, in particular being a member of the editorial board of the Journal of Egyptian Archaeology. And that's quite an impressive and unique post. Not anyone can be a member of the editorial board. So would you talk to us about that as well?
I'm very honored to be the Egyptian member of the editorial board of the Journal of Egyptian Archaeology, and I enjoy very much with my international colleagues doing the revision of international articles and putting some guidelines for the way this very important international British journal is going. This is something which gives you a chance to also work on or play a role in keeping up high standards in the in the Egyptological research. And keeping the standard of such an important journal is quite challenging, but it's also something very enjoyable because you see beforehand fantastic scientific work.
I'd like to ask you about your role model.
My role model, this was a problem, because my role model was my father. So a lot of people have two role models, and the father on one hand and another role model from politics or from cinema. In my case, my role model was in one person. So with his early death, at the age of 54, I lost the role model at the time where I was only about 20 years old. So this was for me a shock for some time. And then it remained difficult because I continued in the same field of my father, and at many times I was always seen in the shadow of my great father, and I had to work very hard and very focused to start really highlighting my own name in the field of Egyptology. So I'm always proud now when they're talking about, say, Tawfiq and Tawfiq Junior, who is Tala Sayyid Tawfiq.
Actually, Dr. Tariq, your father is one of the pioneers in the field of Egyptology. And you have already followed his footsteps to become another important and distinguished Egyptologist. Before I end up this episode, I'd like to finally ask you about your dream.
I dream to have a world-class Grand Egyptian Museum, which can compete with any of the big museums in the world. I dream to develop the Egyptology at Egyptian universities to become the leading Egyptological institutes in the world, as it is worthy of Egypt, as this is our history and these are our antiquities. So my dream is that Egypt becomes the leading center for Egyptology in the world.
Dr. Tariq Said Tawfiq, thank you very much for this interview. That was a celebrity Egyptologist as well as the general director of the Grand Egyptian Museum project, Dr. Tariq Said Tawfiq. We've heard and we've learned about his story of success and about actually also some of his most important researches about his family. And by this, we come to an end of this episode of Story of Success. Until we meet again, it's goodbye.